players, come out to play. Warriors, come out to play. Warriors, come out to play.
In Africa, I had a reason to be born there. God. We have our gods and we have our mode of worship.
Queens, nod your head if you know you got soul. Women, snap your fingers, let your head rap roll. Come on. Kings, got us good like we ain't trap around.
Freedom's what we need, more solutions is the key. Wave the banner of the free, that's the red, black and green. Bringing truth to the streets, war to get no enemy. If it's peace, we at ease, if it's war, we don't cease. EYEs on the crackers and police. Never slack up even when we free, cause we ain't free until we get the land, that's the green. Black power, new African, liberated from the thieves. Nothing better else to be.
Queens, nod your head if you know you got soul. Women, snap your fingers, let your head rap roll. Come on. Kings, got us feeling like we ain't trap brown.
Stimulated cause I'm liberated. Rock me Africa medallion in the middle of the clan. Situation freedom come drum playing by the river. I deliver for my people. It's the sequel of revenge. My friends get rid of every knee shell bow. Every tongue shell tail on the mountain. I reveal. Throw the shells for light side up. Don't run up in my cup. Pour it out and then I strut. A lafia,
E.D. Queens, nod your head if you know you got soul. Head rap roll, come on. Kings, got us feeling like we ain't trap brown. All my brothers, get your hand on your chest now.
When Africa doesn't want to understand or participate in the reason why he was born.
You know you got soul. Women, snap your fingers, let your head rap roll. Come on. Kings, got us feeling like we ain't trap brown. All my brothers, put your hand on your chest now.
See, Africa has not been able to contribute its own knowledge to this universe. But we have knowledge in Africa. You understand?
Yeah, of course.
You see, so all these things need to be in the education system of African countries.
ETM Hotel Rennie Sean, welcome in peace. My name is Sean. I'd like to thank everybody for tuning to the Masi Warrior Clan YouTube channel. Today we're going to build on the rise of ancient Gayo. It has a rich history, but what we're going to take a look at is my notes that were written over a year ago regarding the subject matter. I'm not going to elaborate too much on this particular topic. However, I do want to share with you not only my notes, but a little bit of history about the rich culture and the rise of ancient Gayo. So today we're going to take a look at, I'll have an introduction, some research questions that'll help us along the way. I'll present my hypothesis, argument, and conclusion. And sources will not only be in the description of the video, but at the end of the presentation as well. as we take a trip through Mali, specifically the land of the blacks among the Songhai, and we get into ancient Gayo and its inception. This will be a beautiful journey, and hopefully you can learn with me along the way. When West Africa is discussed, it's usually overgeneralized as if everything is one. However, that is not the case and furthest from the truth, especially when we look back at ancient history. Today, we will learn all about ancient Gayo and its importance in West African history. We will also uncover the importance of Gayo during its reign and what led to its actual fall. Research questions. How did ancient Gayo come to be? What is so significant about Gayo that we need to know its history? When was ancient Gayo first known to us? And what famous person is buried in the land of Gayo? In West African history, Gayo seems to be overlooked, probably because no one famous ever settled there during the era of Arabic writing or influence. However, not many griots tell stories about Gayo, and possibly any legends of Gayo may have been lost due to this. I think we hear about Gayo briefly because it was near Timbuktu, and historians had dedicated a lot of time to Timbuktu due to Arabic influence. As far as famous people being buried in Gayo, I would assume that to be false. And I believe that due to historical differences of Gayo's history, its inception is one hard to determine. This is, of course, Mali. We're dealing with ancient Gayo. Scholarship tends to differ on the inception of ancient Gayo. And when one uses a source like Wikipedia, it may date its inception around the 7th century AD. Arabic sources have its beginning in the 9th century, and some internal sources have its beginning in the 8th century. Our goal today is to hash out the dating suggestions used by Wiki and Arabs and rely on more internal sources to answer the question. Wikipedia relies on Encyclopedia Britannica, whose editor, Kenneth Pletcher, doesn't provide a source for dating its inception in the 7th century. However, that is not only the source Wiki uses to date the start of ancient Gayo. Christopher Arid, second edition, 2016 publication, is also used by Wiki. And while attempting to cross-reference his source, I was unable to verify that date due to the fact I only have a copy of the first edition. Levitian is known for using an 8th century source in the History of West Africa, Volume 1, as he states, it was probably in the 8th century that a new town, Gayo, developed north of Kukuyu as a terminus for the Trans-Saharan Trail. Among Arab scholars, specifically in the corpus of early Arabic sources, the first mention of Gayo was by Al-Khwarizmi. He refers to Gayo as Kaukau and provides the latitude and longitude of his destination. As far as a date, he doesn't profess to provide a date, only its existence. However, Al-Yakubi was known for being the main source of information regarding Kaukau until Al-Bukhari comes around. It is stated in the corpus that he was pivotal in providing and identifying place names and titles. His work provides us with an estimated date of the early 9th century. Several other Arabic sources provide caravans and routes from Kemet to Ghana via Kaukau in 903 AD. However, Ibn Hakal states that the route was abandoned in the late 1800s. Now, Le Wiki, a French source, states that there was evidence of a commercial trade between Kaukau and the Karajite state of Tahart in western Algeria that developed in the late 8th century. Here we have our earliest attestation of trade in the area transitioning into the 9th century, so it would be fair to conclude that a late 8th century, early 9th century date would be more justifiable than Arid's 7th century date. Also, through this trade, the kingdom of Songhai would be known to the Arabs as Kaukau or Gayo, originally. By the time human memory in the form of writing observation emerges as a principal source of information, far earlier West Africa, transitioning from the unconscious communications of archaeological and linguistic records, Gayo or Kaukau was nearly 3,000 years old. The vast majority of Arabic language accounts mentioning West Africa between the 3rd, 9th, and 11th and 17th centuries were penned far from the region, relying on the reports of merchants, travelers, or interviewers with West African pilgrims to the central Islamic lands. This is critical information regarding West African history because a lot of people that actually mention or talk about West Africa were not in the lands of the black. Now that we have answered the question as to when Gayo came to be, we can now look toward the first people who inhabited Gayo. The tradition of the origin of the state attributes its beginning to the coming of together two main groups, the agriculturalists and the fisher folk, to the Dendi region in the southeastern part of Songhai Empire. The fisher folk and agriculturalists were indigenous Mandi people, but as Islam spread, North African Berber Christians fled south from Muslim persecution, which caused a dilemma between the Berbers and the indigenous people, and a fight would pursue and break out. As the North African Berbers imposed their sovereignty over the fisher folk and agriculturalists, it led to the creation of what we know today as the Za or Dia dynasty, which infused strong elements of a Riverian cult. This dynasty would move from Kikuyi to Gayo, where they would set up shop and build a more prominent trading center on the Trans-Saharan route. In the 11th century, Gayo would convert to Islam as the Dia made themselves more exposed, and this important trading center would later fall at the hands of Mali in the 13th century. As it pertains to archaeological evidence around the area of Gayo, as it relates to an Arabic presence in ancient Gayo, evidence for that happens to be very rare. They have yet to find trading items from early Arabs to justify their existence in the area regarding pottery and other items, according to Timothy Insall. Earlier, I mentioned Mali conquered Gayo in the 13th century. It was during the reign of Sunni Dynasty when Kanku Musa ruled. Upon his return from his pilgrimage to Mecca, he waged war on the Za and conquered them, and then had a mosque built in Gayo where he would put a governor to monitor land. But that is not important, as the so-called Berbers, who confused the history of Gayo by maintaining some sort of Yemen origins and pure Arab ancestry. This will muddy the water, especially knowing that today we have been relying on written sources as a basis of early African history. And our only oral accounts of the people of Gayo and a few other places are based on Christian Arab Berbers from the north. Written sources in Arabic in conjunction with the region's epigraphic record and oral traditions render a composite picture of Islam's development in Gayo that, with the exception of ruler list, is surprisingly free of contradiction. As Islam would eventually become a major organizing principle throughout the region, it is possible to plot its rise in a rather strikingly linear progression from the beginning of the 5th, 11th to middle of the 16th, 12th century, when crystallizing a reformist informed Islam, either ideologically divergent or politically disassociated or both. By the later period, Gayo's royal court witnessed an expression of faith influenced by, yet distinguished from, reform efforts characterized the wider scope of North Africa and the Western Sahel. The analysis begins with the Tariq's ruler's list and one El Amayum, said to the founder of Gayo's Zuwad dynasty, a stranger from the east who, when questioned, responds, "I come from Yemen," rendered simply as "he came" or "Ja," the basis for the dynasty's name. The claim is consistent with those of the Berber and Tuaregs, who also maintain Yemeni origins. This is arguably no idle statement, as the reference to Yemen may be claimed to Qahtani or pure Arab ancestry, as opposed to Adani or Arabized Arabs, thereby favorably positioning the Zuwa's relations to constituencies and potential contenders, if not a broader Muslim world. That's the issue with the oral traditions of early Gayo. One of the Gayo's most notable pieces of history is how important it was to one particular Askia. According to the historical account written in the Tariq al-Fatish, this Askia was last known to be heading in the direction of Gayo, where he would enslave some people along the way. Still, ultimately, it would become his final resting place at the end of his life. He was the first of Askias who succeeded the Sunnis. He served under Sunni Ali, aka Ali Burr, who would give power to his child, who would later fall to the Askia. He is Askia Muhammad, who was heavily entrenched in Islamic influence, different from his predecessors, and some would argue Timbuktu played a major role in his politics. The Fatish credits the actual fall of Gayo to the Moroccan invasion in the late 1500s, who captured the city and massacred the people before receiving the word from Moroccan chiefs to do so. This incident speaks to the way Moroccans view blacks despite them accepting Islam. Maybe in the future we will be more specific about this invasion. Unfortunately, met its actual demise from a foreign entity who raided more than just Gayo in its history. One piece of significant archaeological evidence is in the land of Gayo is the Gayo Sani. The Gayo Sani became well known among African historians because of French administrators discovered it here in a cave covered with sand in 1939. Several finely carved marble stelae produced in Almeria in southern Spain. Their inscriptions bear witness of the three kings of the Muslim dynasty bearing alone names, the names of Muhammad and his two successors. From the dates of their deaths, it appears that these kings of Gayo ruled at the end of the 11th and the beginning of the 12th century CE. The history of Gayo can easily be overlooked in the past, especially when you look at the history of Songhai or just Mali in general. What was initially founded by fishermen and agriculturalists ultimately became an intricate piece of real estate according to trade and trade routes along the Sahara. Its inception is not well documented, but according to early accounts of trade in the area, we can conclude that the late 8th century, early 9th century would fit. Askia Muhammad felt some way about Gayo to make it his final resting place. The early history of Gayo would be highly misunderstood due to the early history of writing at the time. However, Gayo has always played a pivotal role in West African history, which was recognized by Malians Mali Kor Kankan Musa when he would conquer the land, build a mosque, and expand his empire. But the actual fall of Gayo was at the hands of Moroccans who massacred and slaughtered a people over political and racist ideology. These are my sources. You can pause the video, capture them, or you can go in the description of the video to obtain more. This concludes our presentation. I appreciate you for tuning in. Please don't forget to like the show, share the show, tell a friend, The Mossy is back at it again.